Hello, good morning everyone. I am Dr. Bhupendra Saha, Assistant Professor of Department of Internal Medicine, BP Koirala Institute of Health Sciences, Dharan. We'll learn about irritable bowel syndrome today. So, objectives of today's discussion are, we'll define what is irritable bowel syndrome. We'll discuss something about the epidemiology, risk factors and pathophysiology of the irritable bowel syndrome. We'll also discuss about the clinical manifestation, diagnosis and the management of the irritable bowel syndrome in today's presentation. What is irritable bowel syndrome? So it is organic or functional? It is functional bowel disorder characterized by abdominal pain or discomfort and altered bowel habit and absence of detectable structural abnormalities. So, what is the history of the patient? Patient will have the abdominal pain or discomfort, may have constipation or diarrhea, but they do not have any structural abnormality. Okay, that's why it's called a functional bowel disorder. So, epidemiology of the irritable bowel syndrome is in around 10 to 20% of the adult population are suffering from irritable bowel syndrome, and it is more prevalent in female. The risk factors for the irritable bowel syndrome are, if someone had history of bacterial gastroenteritis in the past, they are more prone to have IBS in the future. If someone had history of the antibiotic use, then these antibiotic use make prone to have irritable bowel syndrome. So other risk factors are food intolerance, poor quality of life, use of estrogen is also risk factor for IBS, and it usually runs in the family. So these are the some risk factors of the irritable bowel syndrome. So what will be the clinical manifestation of irritable bowel syndrome? The clinical manifestation of irritable bowel syndrome are, number one is, patient will have the chronic abdominal pain. They say, doctor, I have pain. In any area of the abdomen, they can have pain, which usually get aggravated on stress and after food intake, and usually get relieved after passage of the stool. It's a very classical history. And it may not be always pain. Sometimes it may be just a discomfort. But the history will be chronic or maybe sometimes recurrent one. And associated with sometimes diarrhea, loose motion, frequent stool, passage of the stool. Or sometimes it may be associated with constipation, not passing the stool. Sometimes it may be both diarrhea and constipation alternating in different time. So your patient will come to the OPD. They will say, doctor, I have pain in the abdomen. I have taken the so many tablets for gastritis, like this thing, okay. I have visited so many doctors, but still there is pain in my abdomen, like that. And doctor asks, do you have history of some bowel problem? Yes, some of the patients say, oh, I have a diarrhea. The diarrhea, there will be diarrhea when there's a more stress. Some of the patients say, no, doctor, I have a constipation. I do not pass the stool for around 3-4 days. Then I have a pain like that. The history will be like that in a patient with irritable bowel syndrome. So other clinical manifestation, as I have already told, there can be the blotting, like abdominal fullness, and some non-colonic features, like some patient may complain nausea, and some patient may complain epigastric discomfort. Another important or characteristic clinical symptoms that you often get in your patient with IBS is they often give history of other extra intestinal symptoms. Like they give, doctor, I have headache, gripping type of headache. Doctor, I have backache. I have problem in sleep. I feel I am always tired. I do not have energy in my body. Sometimes they will give history. I have increased frequency or urgency of urine. Sometimes they say I have a lower abdominal pain. But most of the patient in my clinical experience, they say some other extra intestinal symptoms too. Okay. So on doing physical examination, usually general physical examinations are normal and systemic examinations are also normal. Sometimes you can get some tenderness in the abdomen. Okay. But patient can come to you and give a history of abdominal pain and sometimes diarrhea or sometimes constipation, but you have to always know some of the DDs, some of the things that can mimic the IBS. Like one important DD is inflammatory bowel disease. Don't forget these conditions, okay? But it is a treatable condition. And if you do not treat in early, like in the early stage, then it may be very, very difficult to treat. And so it may give so many complications in your body. Sometimes colorectal cancer can mimic the IBS. Similarly, celiac screw. Sometimes other gastrointestinal infection, thyroid disorder, and lactose malabsorption can mimic the IBS. That's why don't write IBS at the first. You have to always think, can it be IBS or can it be colorectal carcinoma? Can it be celiac screw? Because IBS is the diagnosis of exclusion. You have to exclude everything, only then you can make IBS. Okay. Now, workup. So the important history is abdominal pain is the most common symptoms, which may be associated with altered bowel habit. Maybe constipation, it may be diarrhea, but it may be both constipation and diarrhea in different time. Features that support your diagnosis is that the pain usually get relieved by bowel movements. And there may be the history of abdominal bloating or distension, then it supports your diagnosis. And presence of other non-GI symptoms like headache or chronic fatigue supports your diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome. Now, Rome, there is something called Rome criteria, and the Rome 4 diagnostic criteria is that recurrent abdominal pain. What recurrent abdominal pain? On average, at least one day per week, pain, full day, one day per week for last 3 months. At least the pain, there should be the history of abdominal pain for 3 months. Okay. Associated with some of the features like that pain get relief with defecation. The pain is associated with change in frequency of stool, but pain is associated with the change in form of the stool. So number one, I think you can understand. So your patient will give a history of pain and they will say, okay, doctor, I have a pain, but that get relief after passage of the stool. Then that is related to the defecation. This is related to the defecation. This one is related to patient. And some of the patients say, doctor, if I am absolutely all right now, but if I have constipation, then I started having the pain. Because there is change in frequency of fistula, constipation. Then this is the second criteria. Someone say, if there is a change in form from loose stools to the hard stools, then I will have pain like that. So if out of these three criteria, minimum two criteria are met, then we can say that our patient have IBS, irritable bowel syndrome. Okay. But before labeling the irritable bowel syndrome, always think about the organic cause, especially in some of the patient, like patient whose age is more than 50 years, you have to always think about the secondaries cause like colorectal carcinoma, unintended weight loss, colorectal carcinoma, blood in stools, colorectal carcinoma, or inflammatory bowel disease, unexplained anemia, definitely colorectal carcinoma. If there is a family history of IBD, colon cancer, celiac disease, then you have to think. Abdominal mass, you have to think. Elevated WBC, you have to think of infection. Loss of appetite, definitely colorectal carcinoma. These are then, if there is a fever, then definitely in some infectious cause. So if your patient say, I have an abdominal pain and there is diarrhea, but in the stool, there is a blood in the stool, then don't make a diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome until and unless you do some test. Okay? Then what are the workup that you are supposed to do? In all patient, you have to at least do the complete blood count and C-reactive protein and fetal calprotectin to exclude IBD or inflammatory conditions. If there is IBD or some other inflammatory condition, we often see there is elevation of the C-reactive protein. If there is elevation of C-reactive protein, then we have to definitely work for the inflammatory condition. If there is anemia, which you can get via the CVC, then definitely you have to think about the alternative cause. Okay? And if the patient has the history of persistent diarrhea, then you may have to work out for the celiac disease. Okay? Or some malabsorption syndromes. Okay? And sometimes you have to do the UGI endoscopy. Okay? If someone has the family history of colon cancer, if they give the history of the weight loss or abdominal mass or rectal bleeding, then definitely you have to do the colonoscopy. If someone has age more than 50 years, then definitely colonoscopy. So based on the presence of the symptoms, you have to work up the patient with IBS. All patient, CVC and C-reactive protein. Diarrhea, persistent diarrhea, definitely you have to work for the celiac disease, some form of gastroenteritis, and the malabsorption syndrome. If there is a family history of colon cancer and history suggestive of colon cancer, then definitely you have to do the colonoscopy and colonic biopsy. Okay, always remember that thing. But what I have seen in some of the patient, we sometimes miss the diagnosis because we label them as a case of irritable bowel syndrome, but later on they have the gastric malignancies. So if you're labeling someone is having the IBS, we have to always think about this organic cause. Okay. Now, how you are going to manage the patient with the irritable bowel syndrome? So sometimes some of the doctors may get irritated when they see a patient with IBS. When they sit just next to you, they say, "Doctor, do I have a cancer? Cancer, Chucky? I can't talk to anyone. Can it be treated? Because I have visited so many doctors, but still there is abdominal pain." Like that time, they have multiple complaints, and you should have patience to listen to all the problems and the complaint of your patient. Only then you can go ahead. Otherwise, if you go on interrupting your patient, if you are not listening to your patient, and it's very difficult to treat a patient with IBS. It's very difficult. They are not going to get satisfied with your treatment. So the management is, as I have already told, the number one is make a confident diagnosis. To say the IBS, you should take a very, very proper history. You have to search for the extra intestinal symptoms, and you have to always be vigilant regarding the alternative diagnosis. And after doing all these tests, and if you can say it's the case of IBS, then only you can say, you can explain your patient. If the chronic condition, but benign. If the chronic, you can have the abdominal pain for the long time, but it's benign, don't worry. You can have even the fluctuating course, sometimes you may be all right, sometimes you may be the pain. But don't worry, this is benign. If you do the some exercises or if you are stress free, then your symptoms will go down. So that's why we need to advise them a good diet, doing exercises, yoga, stress management, like that. In the fourth step, even with this stress management or yoga or diet therapy, if they do not improve, then you may have to give the pharmacological treatment, drugs, only after that. Okay. So the number one first step is reassurance and education. As I have already told, you have to counsel your patient regarding the chronic nature but benign nature of this condition, regarding the fluctuating nature of this condition. Okay. So diet, definitely healthy diet they should take. They should take less milk product, meat product, caffeine and gas forming food like radish, cauliflower, cabbage, beans. They should avoid, because if they take those type of food, then definitely they will have more symptoms. And we have to encourage them to take the more fiber diet, and this will be more useful in a patient with constipation predominant IBS. Okay, then medications. For medications, we have to know what type of IBS your patient is having. If your patient is having the constipation predominant IBS, then definitely you can try with osmotic laxative like lactulose or polyethylene glycol. Okay. And newer drugs are coming up. They are linaprotide and lubiprostone. These are the new drugs may be useful in constipation predominant irritable bowel syndrome. Okay, just you know the name of the drug. Okay. So if someone has the diarrhea predominant IBS, then you have to use the antimotility drugs like loperamide. And sometimes you have to use the eloxdoline and cholestyramine. Okay, these are the drugs that can be given in a diarrhea predominant IBS patient. Okay, loperamide, eloxdoline, and cholestyramine. Other drugs that can be given in a patient with diarrhea predominant IBS are ondansetron and rifaximin. Okay, you can try these drugs. And if someone has the pain, severe pain, then you can try the antispasmodic, okay, and like isobutyl bromide. And if someone has the refractory pain in the abdominal and diarrhea, like most of the physicians use the tricyclic antidepressant like amitriptyline for them. And if some person has the abdominal pain and constipation predominant, you can use the SSRI like fluoxetine or sertraline, you can use. So, but as I have already told, some of the patients are refractory and we have to give the tricyclic antidepressant for the long time. And sometimes we have to use the pregabalin for the pain dominant symptoms, and definitely there is need of psychotherapy in that group of patient. So take home message is IBS is a functional gastrointestinal disorder. That's why you have to always look for the organic cause for that symptoms before leveling the diagnosis of IBS. The abdominal pain is the main symptoms, which usually get aggravated on food intake and may be associated with the diarrhea or constipation or both. We have to always rule out the alternative by doing some tests like CBC and C-reactive protein for all the patient, colonoscopy for the person whose age is more than 50 years or who gave the history suggestive of colon cancer, and other serological and upper GI endoscopy, especially in a diarrhea predominant IBS patient. And definitely, we have to treat the treatment of the patient is according to the type of IBS. But for the all type of IBS, making definite diagnosis, counseling, reassuring, advising for the good diet, exercise, yoga is must. And for the constipation predominant, we often give the osmotic laxative. And for the diarrhea predominant, we often give the loperamide. And for the management of the pain, we can give the antispasmodic or TCA or SSRI. But good patient-physician relationship and use of person-centered care is the key to the success for the management of the irritable bowel syndrome. Thank you. Thank you so much for kind attention. If you have any queries, you can write in a comment section. Till then, bye-bye.